Cool. Now we come to the cast. This movie was initially released in Japan with a Japanese cast, and I have kept the English-speaking cast with them, but we'll talk about the English dubbing a little later. So, Yoji Matsuda as Azbil, the Pajait rebel, and in the English version, American actor Shia LaBeouf as that character. This is before Transformers and Indiana Jones days for him. So he's a little known actor, not very well known. Shumi Shimamoto as Nausicaa in Japanese version. Alison Lohman as Nausicaa in the English version. Goro Naya as Master Yupa. Patrick Stewart, very well known English actor as the voice in the English dub. Mujihito as Mayor of Pajit. Mark Hamill as the Mayor of Pajit in the English. So Mark Hamill is a very well-known American actor, known for his Luke Skywalker character in Star Wars and the voice of Joker in the Batman animated series. So he did voice work for that. Yoshiko Sakakibara as Princess Kushana, and well-known American actress Uma Thurman as the English dub, and Imasa Kayomi as Kurotawa, and Chris Sarandon as the same character in the English dub. But there are many, many. I've just listed the main ones. And then we come to the actual voice recording. So I want to say a thing before we start the video. What you're seeing here is, I need to give you a little information about what is going on here. This movie was released in, like I said, in 1984 as Japanese, so with that Japanese cast, voice cast. And then in 2005 by Disney. And Disney, I'll get into the actual history of what happened, acquired the rights to make this English version and release it in 2005. So what you're seeing now is a behind the scenes of the English dub, because they went on to make a behind the scenes and create a small documentary on the voices in the movie. So what you're going to see is only the interviews and dubbing sessions of the English dub. This is the only thing that is available about the voices. And this documentary is called Behind the Microphone.
To be a part of Miyazaki's very first feature and to see where he started in relationship to where he is now is thrilling. I'm honored, and what a cast.
It's a really talented cast. Alison Lohman is really soft and subtle and sweet.
You must be tired after running from that ohm.
What really interested me with this character is that the way Miyazaki did it. She's very free and young and girly with the little skirt and the high boots, very stylish, yet she's this strong-willed, independent, just commands authority. It's just these great contrasts for this girl.
Wow, is that a fox squirrel? I've never seen one before.
I'd never done this before, so it was really new to me.
Don't watch.
With live action, it's easier for it to come out natural. But with animation, it's different because you don't necessarily know the context and you just have this line. So it does take a bit of work to kind of get there, and to have the writers right there changing the wording to kind of make it fit you, and the director there to kind of guide you with the different inflections.
Ohm, go back to the jungle. This is not your world.
And she's not too hysterical here. She's just kind of trying to be calming.
Ohm, go back to the jungle. This is not your world.
So it's definitely a collaboration of really talented people.
He's perfect. Will you let me keep him, Lord Yupa?
Villagers, we have come to your land in the name of peace.
I play a character, Kushana, who is the commander of the Tamikian army.
Move out!
I start out looking at her as a villain, because that's always sort of fun. But most people don't think that they're causing harm. Most people think when they do things that they're doing what they have to do. You have to get inside, what is it that a person is thinking that they're trying to achieve?
Follow us and join our enterprise. We shall put the toxic jungle to the torch.
One of the things with my character is that she's got this mask on to protect her, you know, most of the time. So all you could see of her was her eyes. And occasionally, her eyebrow would raise. We would make sure that we matched the voice to, you know, the tiny little, tiniest gestures. Having actually studied Japanese, its rhythms are really different than English. And so what we kind of relate to emotionally in the English language, when our voices go up, when our voices go down.
While I'm gone, begin to awaken the warrior.
For Japanese pronunciation, is a totally different orientation. The measure of it was a little different, but that was, you know, a balance between the speed of the actor and the emotion and the writing.
You're letting me go?
Yes, granted that you return to your kingdom.
I did get to hear some of Patrick Stewart's voice, and that was very inspiring. I mean, he is one of the great voices, and the way he uses language is beautiful.
What are you doing here? This chamber is filled with toxic plants.
I find a certain liberty that comes with doing voiceovers, that you have an image to work from. There are already indications of what someone will look like. So therefore, the interesting thing is to find the voice that matches those images.
Don't worry about that. Our only concern is that the warrior stay dormant.
This was the first time that I've ever dubbed a voice from another language. We were blessed with one distinct advantage in this, in that the character that I play is either wearing a mask or his mouth is entirely covered with a large mustache. So I was never having to lip sync. What I was doing was mustache syncing, because his mustache moves as he talks. So I have yet to face my first encounter of lip syncing a foreign language.
Welcome back, Lord Yupa.
Why, Mito, you're looking fit.
Whatever kind of discipline you're working, you use the same instrument, still using the same voice, but you use it in different ways. You can accent it using different kinds of human emotion.
What are we supposed to do? I can't just sit here and watch our valley be destroyed.
The characters are created, and we just kind of have to find the rhythm of what they're doing and try to blend in a reality into it.
Looking good.
I'm Asbel from the land of Pejite.
I've never done an animation this scale or worked with people this respected in this field ever.
Somehow, we are going to have to find a way to stop this toxic jungle from spreading.
And to play a prince is weird, because I'm so far away from that. The hardest part for me was like getting the enunciation down, because when I talk, I slur and I say we're instead of we are, and it's instead of it is.
Ah, these nuts taste awful, what are they?
I think I laughed more than I said lines.
This isn't a nut, this is penicillin.
We were just cracking jokes the entire time, and there's not a lot of pressure, it's just enjoyable. But the film is what's getting watched, not you. That's where the focus is.
Let go of the princess, now!
Calm down, asshole!
It's wonderful because most of the animation directors look at you with their ears. They don't want to be distracted by how you appear.
The Tomikins want to destroy the world.
Thanks, good read.
People will say in animation, can you add about 20 pounds to that voice?
And you sort of find a way to get heavier.
That's why I compare it to radio acting, because I'm able to play parts I would never get if I were doing it on camera.
But once we have the warrior, we'll burn the jungle and take back the earth.
One thing I found about playing villains is that the characters don't see themselves as villainous.
But what should we do? Surrender and become the slaves of the Tolmekians?
Rather than sort of a gritty, hard-edged, villainous kind of, you know, stereotyped, villainous voice, they wanted me to be more warm, which I think is wonderful, because the conflict is always set in motion by the so-called villains.
You're awakening long-forgotten ambitions, even in a lazy old soldier like me.
I don't think that most audiences, at least up until fairly recently, were aware of the amount of work and the extraordinary imagination that it takes to both create, and in this version, to recreate, the voice work. I'm doing the English version of a character that's already been animated in Japanese.
Hold your positions! Hold it! Wait! We must stand our ground until Her Highness returns!
So I'm sitting in the booth, listening to the Japanese actor, and watching the version on the screen that I'm supposed to be lip-syncing to, and it's a little surreal, but great fun.
It's falling apart! I knew it was too soon!
The way they have my character animated in the piece, there's a lot of, and I can only sort of do an imitation of the way they've got him drawn, there's a lot of this, where his mouth kind of goes like that. There's a sort of crooked grin on his face all the time. And it was a wonderful sort of character key for me because it showed me that here's a man who's in the midst of this very difficult and horrible situation, and he always sees the irony in it.
Yes, I do see your point.
It'll be a part of the English version of Miyazaki's first movie is, and I don't use this word lightly, an honor.
I'm very, very proud to be a part of it.
I love the way that the film comes out.
This is a thrill. This is outstanding work.
This film definitely is a landmark film. It's Miyazaki's work that really inspired me.
Just to be a small part of an ensemble cast in a Miyazaki film is a thrill.
He's a great, renowned artist, Miyazaki, and to get to play a character in one of his movies is a real treat, and I love doing it.
So that was about the voice casting and how it was dubbed into English. The next thing is the music. The music was composed by Joe Hisaishi. And I have a clip of this being performed to a live audience. It's a 10-minute clip, but would you like to see like a couple of minutes of that clip to see how the music is composed? Yeah? So we can play that. What you basically saw right now is the opening, the music over the opening titles. So like this, the movie has a number of themes that are going on, a number of scenes that are happening. And for each scene, a different score is composed as a background, as the background music. And all the scenes were composed by Joe Hisaishi for this. So he was not only the composer, he was also the music director of the film. So all the background score in this movie was composed by him. Yeah? Okay, so that's the sound and the music. Now we come to the actual design. I will break it into what was done for the manga and what was done for the movie. So what you're seeing here is, as you all know, that the manga was black and white. So what you're seeing here are some of the covers and some watercolor impressions that Miyazaki did for some of the artwork anyways. Okay, and then you'll also see the actual artwork. So these are some of the covers for the, and these are some of the panels. These don't appear like this in the comic, but he did watercolor impressions of some of them, and I found them, so I collected them for you guys. This is one of the covers. This is one of the panels. Another panel, one of the covers, one of the panels, one of the covers. And this is actually how the drawing looks in the manga. Now, the thing about the special note that I want to give here is that although this is this looks like ink, Miyazaki never used to draw in ink. He used to always draw in pencil. And the drawings that come out in pencil don't come out very well in print. So the original one will look very good, but you can't make prints out of it because the color is gray and black and white printers, whatever the technology was there for printing at that time, they were just leaving gaps where the pencil was too light. So they actually, this is the note which is mentioned there, that they actually had to go through a double process of darkening his pencil lines before printing it. So this was an added task with the printers that they had to do because Miyazaki simply refused to use pen. He said, I'm not a pen artist, I'm a pencil artist. And his original art is entirely in graphite pencil. So here are a few examples. Oh, what am I pressing? Wrong remote. Few examples of his original art. So these are the giants which are in the opening. These are what you would say a model sheet. Whenever a character is designed, there is a lot of information that is put into the character. So her hair, her clothing, her everything that she's wearing in her case is very, very why am I missing the word? She only is, because she is flying, she only carries things that she needs to do the work that she's doing. So every single thing on her body has some or the other use. She's just not wearing it as a gown, a dressing. It is, what is the word? Where you have something that you use.
It's functional, it's not functional.
Exactly.
That's the word. Everything that she's wearing has some or the other function. So functional clothing, including the, you know, mustache-looking mask and all that. This was one of the things when this movie was released to American audiences, was that why do their masks have mustache attached to it? You know, because they could not understand the usage of it. So yeah, so these are all the notes that Miyazaki made. And this is the serialization of the comic book starting in. So this is showing you the month is first, the chapter, and then the number of the month, the chapter, I don't know, something. So this is how from 1982 to 1984 or 96. 94 and 96, the movies were released, the manga was released in the magazine. So as you can see that there are gaps also. There were months in which the comic was not written because Miyazaki then got busy making the movie. So he actually took break from making the manga to make the movie and then, you know, again started writing for some time, then took a break, then again started writing, took a break, again started writing, took a break, and then in the year, I think it is 1994, he finished the manga. And then what you can see here is the volume. So these many were put together in volume 1, volume 2, volume 3, volume 4, volume 5, 6, and 7. So these can now be found as graphic novel volumes in publication. because the manga serialization in the magazine is finished. Okay, so this is about the manga. So now the concept design that was done for the movie. This was the first poster that was designed for the promotion of the movie when it was released in Japan. And these are, again, artworks with watercolor impressions that Miyazaki did as concept design for the movie. So this is now his artwork for the movie, not the manga. So this is the character. These are some of the places, so designs for the Valley of the Wind, her clothing, this is Asbel, this is her interacting with the other warriors of the Valley of the Wind, this is one of the scenes, this is her childhood memory of saving the Om baby, this is her in action. This is the first starting of the movie when we see that devastated city where Lord Yupa is scavenging. This is the concept design for that. This is Nausicaa in flight. This is the concept design for Nausicaa's palace, castle, not palace, with the two windmills. And this is the brought down ship. And this is the artwork that Miyazaki did for the tapestry, which is used in the opening titles. So this tapestry is actually telling stories in the, you know, this is where they are building the giants part by part. This is where the giant turns on humans and destroys their cities. People, plants, animals, everybody's getting blown away. And then there is this concept of a dual-headed snake, which is also the flag of the Ptolemaeans, and the rise of a white-clothed princess, which is Princess Kushana. And then this is showing the insects which fly without flapping their wings. This is the toxic forest, and then this is the prophecy of a girl in flight in blue clothing who's going to bring about peace and unite the people, the surviving people of the living world. So this is all done in tapestry side, and this whole tapestry goes about while the opening titles are rolling. And then what happens is once these concept designs are done, they are given to the animation studio to build the storyboards. So here are some of the storyboards built by Topcraft, which is the animation studio that made this movie. So some of the storyboards. And then one of the things that they have to do at concept design stage while doing storyboarding is that they have to set a color palette. So these are what is called the color script. And it basically shows the color themes for each scene. So here are a few examples. So greens, blues, desert, dead lands, more dead lands, the aggravated assaults. So they have used different color themes, blues, greens, reds, to show different incidents in the movie. So this is basically where they develop the color palette, which is used throughout the movie. And this is done at concept design stage. These you don't see in the actual movie. The actual movie has those clean line designs which then follow this palette. And then one of the things that this has happened is with the bankruptcy of the studio that made this movie, there is not much information left in any archives of the actual animation process. We can get a lot of such information from Studio Ghibli movies, but since this movie was before that, the only thing I could find is in one of the books that was released for this movie, where they have shown how the final design, what you see on the screen, goes through actually a few steps before it reaches the stage where you see it. So the first stage is rough. So the artist will draw a rough sketch. And then this stage is known as the original. It's not very clear where Miyazaki or some senior artist will take that rough and finalize it. So if there are any changes to be made, if there are any suggestions, all those things will be. So this then becomes the original. And then there is something called as a cleanup artist who will sit with that mildly rough but finalized original and make very clean line drawings of that. So this is now known as a cleaned up drawing. And then the ink and paint artist will get it and put the ink and paint based on the palette that has been finalized for that scene. Okay, so this is the step of what happens to bring a single frame onto the movie. I have one more example of this. This is also similarly, so this is a rough sketch by an artist. This is, this is the rough one, and this is the cleanup one, and then this is the ink and painted artwork, and this is what you finally see in the movie. Okay? Now, as I said, I don't have any much information about the actual animation process, but this movie was animated as a cel animation, 2D hand-drawn traditional animation style. And I have explored this animation style over many other movies that I have done Cine-master class for. So if you want to know how the actual animation is done in 2D animation, we have all the presentations recorded and uploaded on the YouTube channel and the PeerTube channel of Aurofilm. So you can refer to those for seeing how actual 2D animation is done. I will now move on to one of the most significant incidents that happened in the history of this movie, which was very significant in how Studio Ghibli released its movies after this movie. So what happened was, this is the timeline of the release of all the media for this movie. In 1982, the manga was released. 1984, the movie was released in Japan. 1985, a hugely edited version of the movie was released in the US. And I will talk about what was changed in that release. And finally, in 2005, the uncut version of the exact copy of the original Japanese animation was dubbed and released in English for physical media like DVDs, Blu-ray, VHS, and all that. And this was done by Walt Disney Studios. And I will just go through the story of how this all happened. Okay, so in 1984, the movie was released to Japanese audiences. Great success, critical acclaim, financial acclaim. Won many, many Japanese awards, including Best Japanese Film, Best Anime. This company, by the name New World Pictures, approached Miyazaki and his producer, Toshio Suzuki, to release this movie overseas. And they agreed to do this because this distributor was known to release many foreign films in America. So there are many, many foreign, hugely reputed films that this studio released in America and to great acclaim and to great success. So they had a history of releasing these amazing, beautiful movies made by overseas directors in their native language in America. And there are Academy Award winning movies. There are many, many prestigious movies that this studio had released as part of their history, including this one. It was also released by the same studio that released Nausicaa. So when they came to Toshio Suzuki to acquire the rights to release this movie in America, he was pretty convinced that they would do a good job. And they didn't give it a thought about what they would actually do before releasing this movie in America. Now, they went on to remove 23.36 minutes of, that is 23 minutes and 36 seconds of this movie. They edited it out and released the movie in America with 23.36 minutes of footage cut. Okay? And these were basically all the parts of the story which actually address the environmentalism in the movie. These were all the parts of the stories that actually developed the character of Nausicaa. These were all the parts of the story that talked about the history of Japan, history of this world, which is realized in Japanese culture. They cut out all that.
And without asking anything,
without taking any permission, nothing. They just got the right, and then they got the license to re-release it, and they did this. So, great.
Legally, they are authorized to do that?
There was no clause, because Miyazaki and Suzuki never thought they would do something like this. They just trusted them as a reputed studio which had released so many international movies. So they didn't realize that they would butcher their movie like this. And I have a list of few scenes which I will show you were removed from the movie, and then you decide what a good job they did. Yeah, they removed the entire title sequence with the tapestry. So people don't get introduced to what happened 1,000 years back, because that is shown in this title. They changed the name of the movie. They called it Warriors of the. It was released as Warriors of the Wind. This is the poster of the movie, which was when it was released in Japan. This is another poster of the movie, which was when the movie was released in Japan. And this is the poster that New Line Media used for promoting this movie in America.
It's like a movie.
Yes, I'm going to talk about each part of this movie, this poster. First, look at who's in the center. Who is this guy? He's not in the movie. Skeletor. Not in the movie. This guy's in the movie, but he's in the opening sequence, which is not in the movie, because they cut it. They removed the entire opening sequence. Look at what they're riding. This guy. They are riding it. Nowhere in the movie does anybody ride the giant. Who is this guy? He's a Middle Eastern character, Middle Eastern looking character with a gun in his hand, riding a winged horse, which is not in the movie. This one is in the movie. Who is she? On one corner of the poster. This is the text on the poster. The most fantastic family adventure in a world 1,000 years from now. Heroes, demons, conquerors, creatures, and a band of young warriors. Which movie are we talking about? On the wings of their greatest challenge. The future has never been so exciting. So they completely demonized the promotion of the movie. And then, so like I said, they removed the entire title sequence. Everything, the destruction, everything. This entire sequence was gone, so people didn't know what the giants were. This entire sequence of how the devastation affected people is gone. The opening sequence where Princess Nausicaa is exploring the toxic waste and finds the Om shell is gone. They only show that she finds the Om shell, she goes in for the eye, and a second later she has the eye. The entire sequence of her finding the hardness of the shell, her realizing how her people can use this hard shell, her putting the knife and, you know, having that entire thing is gone. And those are the ones that build her character. Her knowledge about how she puts the gunpowder around the shell sparks it with her gun. All that thing is gone. They just show that she finds it, and she picks up the eye shell, and the spores happen, and she's back in the village. That entire sequence is gone. So her entire character development is gone. When Lord Yupa comes to the village, that entire sequence is gone. So his relationship with the villagers is completely gone. How they give him the baby, how they trust him with the baby, how they tease him that Nausicaa saved you. So his entire relationship with the village, with Nausicaa, the whole thing is gone. So the movie starts with Nausicaa fighting that Om and saving Lord Yupa. So all the action stuff is still there. But all the character moments, everything is gone. The villagers fighting the small intrusions are gone. And that is the central theme of the movie, that we fight it with small fires. Big fire burns everything. Is gone. Lord Yupa finding Nausicaa's secret room is gone. And this is where she talks about how the underground water is purifying the forest. This whole sequence is gone. Nausicaa surrendering to the Ptolemaeans is gone. So her relationship with the people is gone. They're giving him her gifts, crying for her, entire thing is gone. Nausicaa's dream sequence is gone, where she saves the Om as a child, the baby Om. Nausicaa's exploration of the underground forest is gone. So there is no point in the movie where they talk about how the forest is purifying the... So all the environmental messages are gone, basically. Them fighting the spores is gone. Oh my God, so many scenes. Nausicaa pleading the Pajait not to bring in the Oms, gone. Asbel rescuing Nausicaa, gone. Princess Kushana and her... Kurotawa having a conversation about whether they should destroy, attack, or wait for the giant to wake up. Gone. The end credits, gone. The whole sequence where they say that now the war has ended, the Pajais stay back to revive, the Ptolemaeans go back, that entire part is gone. And also, in addition to this, they changed all the characters' names. So, because Nausicaa, who is this? Zandra. Oh, Princess Zandra. Princess Kushana became Queen Selina. Absel became Prince Milo. This is the worst. The land of Pajait.
So you can see the butchering that is happening here.
Oh man, there is an actual website which lists all the atrocities that was done to this movie with this release. This is 1985 release of this movie in America.
It gets some success in the US.
Sorry?
It gets some success, this movie, in the US.
And see, it was just promoted as another action, Japanese action movie.
And at this time, when this is going on, the 80s, if you look at Japanese animation, you know, it's like, hey, I've come to kill you. I will reduce you into smog. This is Japanese animation when they translate. So this is happening on TV, the Japanese cartoons that we used to see on TV. So you can imagine who went to see this movie in theaters. Okay, so when the movie was actually released, it got, in its true form, it got a lot of critical acclaim. Here are a few quotes. This is Theron Martin of Anime News Network, who praised the film for its character designs, Hayao Miyazaki's direction, and Joe Hisaishi's score. He also said that the film deserves a place in any shortlist of all-time classic anime movies. Common Sense Media, which is a service to inform parents about media for children, rated the film positively and cited its good role models and positive messages, but also cautioned parents about its dramatic setting and violent scenes. Helen McCarthy, in her book 500 Essential Anime Movies, praised the animation techniques of Miyazaki, stating that the real strength of this film is the script, packed with incident, excitement, and passion, and the soundtrack of Joe Hisaishi. And on the website Rotten Tomatoes, this sits at a fresh tomato rate of 89% by critics and 88% by audiences that saw this movie. And that brings me to the conclusion of this presentation. Thank you for coming by. I have a 9-minute video on the analysis of the environmental messages in this movie. So if you guys are interested, I can play that movie, that video. And it's an analysis by an independent content creator. Or we can stop here and...
Nausicaä of the Valley of the Wind is a 1984 animated film directed by Hayao Miyazaki. The toxic jungle is called the Sea of Decay or Sea of Corruption in other translations, but for the sake of uniformity, the term toxic jungle will be used here. Environmentalism from a philosophical viewpoint can be summarized with this question. What obligations do we have to our natural environment? Various religions have God-given or gods-given answers to that question. This is sometimes called stewardship, the theological belief that we, as humans, are responsible for the earth. Tu Bishvat is a Jewish holiday, the New Year of the Trees. In modern Israel, the day is celebrated as a kind of environmental awareness day, and trees are planted in celebration. Christian stewardship refers to the responsibility that Christians have in maintaining what God has given them. In Hinduism, the Pancha Mahabhutas, or the five great elements, creates a web of life. A more secular view of environmental philosophy is to simply answer that we will be lost if we do not control our actions towards our environment. This is referred to as anthropocentrism. This refers to an ethical framework that grants moral standing solely to human beings. However, many claim that is wrong. Philosopher Peter Singer famously wished to extend moral standing to non-human animals, stating that the ability to feel pain or pleasure indicates sentience. All the arguments to prove man's superiority cannot shatter this hard fact. In suffering, the animals are our equals. For some philosophers, superiority does not create fewer moral obligations. It follows that it may even create greater superior obligations. Nausicaä of the Valley of the Wind does not take the positions of anthropocentrism and opts for something resembling animism, the concept that everything has a spirit, that nature is a part of us, and that we are part of the lives of non-human animals. We actually see this a lot in Miyazaki's filmography. He portrays worlds in which humans and the spiritual world are connected, worlds in which humans and animals are connected, worlds in which humans and nature are connected. Generally, his films showcase an earth in which everything is intertwined on an emotional and spiritual level. Humans are not granted the earth to use as they please by God, and they are not given stewardship over his creation either. Humans are simply another consequence of nature in Miyazaki's films. The film also rejects anthropocentrism. Nausicaä cares deeply for the insects. They are at times the harbingers of death, and at other times the key to life. Nausicaä, both the film thematically and the character actively, grants moral standing to non-human animals. Their importance, their lives, are just as integral to the world as the human beings' lives. In the film, the trees of the toxic jungle evolved to purify the earth of all the pollution that humans made. The trees absorb the pollution so that it becomes inert. The insects evolved to guard the toxic jungle. It will take centuries for the trees to cleanse the earth, which means the humans are unwilling to cohabitate with the insects for that long. In the film, the trees are connected to the actions of human beings because they changed to cure pollution that was man-made, and the animals changed to protect the trees. Nausicaä believes in the value of life, whatever form that may take. Environmentalism need not be entrenched in myth and supernaturalism, of course. Protecting the earth benefits ourselves because an atmosphere that is inhabitable to humans is not in any human's self-interest. However, fiction and fantasy can be more persuasive than hard facts. After all, hard facts have not yet been enough to persuade everyone about ongoing environmental threats to humanity and nature in general. The name Nausicaa comes from the Odyssey. Nausicaa in the Odyssey was said to take delight in nature and have a receptive personality. The film's Nausicaa obviously is a caretaker of nature, and her personality is able to transcend the limitations in communications among species. Any Christian imagery is apparently accidental. Nausicaa being a kind of foretold savior who seemingly comes back to life was not intended to represent Jesus Christ. Although many Christians see this in the film, bear in mind that Christianity accounts for about 1% of the population of Japan. An undercurrent of Buddhism and Shinto, however, flow throughout the film. The Buddhist roots of evil are shown in the film: greed, ill will, and delusion. Fear of the toxic jungle and insects is what drives the conflict between Tolmekia and its neighbors. This results in greed over who should own the great warrior and ill will towards various people. Shinto, Japanese native religion, is seen in the film as well, as the religion insists on honoring nature. Trees, mountains, the water, animals, and humans possess kami, or spirit. Nausicaa's respect for all nature seems to be rooted in Shinto. The decision to make the animals these grotesque insects is a curious one. The film says that the environment must be preserved for both humans and animals, even if these animals are not the cute and cuddly variety. This is Miyazaki's most outright and unambiguously environmentalist film. It's no great surprise that it was supported by the World Wildlife Fund for Nature, but that is not everything that the film expresses. The danger of nuclear proliferation is consistently highlighted in the film, the great warriors being the obvious stand-ins for nuclear weapons. Miyazaki's films often contain anti-war sentiment. In Nausicaa of the Valley of the Wind, two competing nations struggle over weapons supremacy. Each desires access to the great warrior while the rest of the world watches in horror and tries to get them both to stand down. I'm going to assume we're all on the same Cold War page here. Tolmekia believes it must use the great warrior in order to ensure the safety of humanity, and Pajit believes it must destroy Tolmekia and anyone in conquered Tolmekian territory to ensure that this does not happen. Both have violent, militaristic goals with a lot of collateral damage, and each nation thinks itself entirely justified. In the end, neither of their war plans work out. Princess Kushana of the Tolmekians uses the Great Warrior, this doomsday weapon, against the insects, but it is not enough. The people of Pajit eventually throw down their arms and help the valley rebuild. Only Nausicaa has the right idea. She seeks a peaceful solution to the conflict. She takes care of the insects rather than demonizing them. She works towards a habitable world between the humans and insects rather than attempting to destroy the toxic jungle, endangering everyone in hopes of a greater victory. Japan understands the devastation of nuclear weapons more than any other country. It is the only nation to have been victim of nuclear weapons during wartime. Japan has been reticent for a long time to create a powerful military, not to mention being constitutionally barred from doing so. In recent years, Japan's military has been growing again, blamed on shifting security dynamics in the region. Miyazaki has spoken out against this, in spite of the obvious backlash that would create in his own country. Even the scenes of violence in the film are not sensationalist. There is no joy in the violence. It does not glorify warfare. In the film, war is terrifying. Lord Yupa is called the greatest swordsman in the world, but when he is forced to draw his blades, he always uses them non-lethally to end a dispute. He stands between Nausicaa and someone she is trying to harm. He quells an attack on himself without cutting anybody's throat. Even the violence of the film is anti-violence. Nausicaa tries to solve problems with science and diplomacy. Many characters in the film have shades of gray to them. Nausicaa is strong and brave, never a damsel in distress, which is true of a lot of Miyazaki's women protagonists throughout his filmography, but she also violently loses her temper. The villainous Kushana mistakenly believes what she is doing is right. The people of Pajit believe their ends justify the means. Ezbel has conflicting feelings and changes allegiances to help Nausicaa. This is not a failing or a muddying of the issue, though. Nausicaä of the Valley of the Wind simply acknowledges that the world is not cast in black and white. That would be too simplistic for this director. But the anti-war stance, on the other hand, is non-negotiable. Another war with nuclear weapons is not a matter of black and white. It's life and death.
Yeah, so there's a lot that can be discussed about what is said in this video. The basic theme, the central theme is, since it was created by a Japanese gentleman, the undertones are mostly set in the Japanese concept of Shinto, which has three major central ideas, that is greed, ill will, and delusion. Delusion, wrong ideas about how things work. And during my research, I found so much content on why things go wrong. You know, there's one line that I found that fear and ignorance, not logic, leads to war. So this is very well shown in this movie, because this is what is happening with Kushana and the Pajait, that they are afraid of the jungle, the toxic forest. They are afraid of the stampeding ohms. But they don't know that why is this happening. They don't understand why is this happening. And this is what Nausicaa finds out, that under the toxic forest, there is actually a whole revival going on, which will take thousands of years to revive the entire planet. And since Kushana is unaware of this, she feels that if she destroys the toxic jungle, she will revive the planet's atmosphere. And in that attempt, she knows that to destroy such a unstoppable force, the moment she realizes that there is a dormant giant under the Pajait kingdom, the first introduction is through the kidnapping of the giant and the Pajait princess, who dies in the crash landing that is near the beginning of the movie. And so this is the whole idea that she's afraid and she's ignorant. And that is what is leading her to go on such a warpath. And then the Pajait are reacting from greed, because they feel that if the Tolmekians find a solution, then they will become world rulers, and we will have to serve them. So they want their own hold on the world. And in their greed, they release or they get the ohms to stampede by stealing their baby so that they can stop Kushana from using the giant, without understanding that in either case, the final outcome is total devastation. So this is the underlying thematic philosophical ideas in this film. I mean, you guys have seen the movie. If you have any ideas, because this is what I found out from my research. And of course, there's one more thing which, if you guys are interested, I'll touch into, is that this is one of the first portrayals of a girl character, a princess character, which subverts most of the tropes of a Disney princess's character. You know, how a Disney princess is portrayed and how their stories are told. This particular character and the story that is told through her debunks and shows her in a very different light. And this is also why this movie is so landmark. The viewers got a very different sense of a girl being a leader by her actions, and not because she is the daughter of a king. And showing that because of this particular character trait, she is loved by her people. She's not loved by her people just because she is the sultan's daughter or the king's, you know, the princess of the country. So she has earned it. And she's not just, you know, a damsel in distress who is going to go on this hero's journey. She's already a hero. It's not the hero's journey of her stepping out into the unknown and finding, you know, initially getting help from others and then finding her footing and then having that hero's moment, she is already, you know, because she grew up in that environment, she has grown up interacting with adverse conditions. She's not grown up inside a palace with servants and guards and in a protected environment. And now she's going into the unknown and unexpected and dangerous environment. That is why the opening sequence is so important and should not have been cut in the release in 1985, because it establishes her as this leading personality who is not only followed by, but loved by her people. And I mean, there's a whole list of things, how she subverts the Disney princess tropes. Maybe another day. It's a bit late. Okay, thank you for coming. And cheers. I hope you enjoyed the movie also. Cool. That's it.
But I have a question, maybe yes. You told it already, but Nausicaa is Egyptian, no?
No,
she's
Greek.
Greek. And what is the story? Same story, more or less?
No. Only her name.
Do you know why he chose this name?
Yes, because the character in the Greek mythology, Homer's Odyssey, has similar character traits as the princess. She's very in touch with her environment. She's very empathetic. She helps people. She is very, we actually discussed this in the presentation.
Yeah, okay.
But yeah, I mean, there are many, many traits in Nausicaa. And even the sound of the word was very, he really liked the name Nausicaa. And that's why he chose that name as the...
Musica.
Cool. Thank you. Cheers. Good night.